So I'm very pleased to have a speaker today from Jussieu Paris. He's also at Harvard University, Eldon Elmato, and he'll be talking about motivic cohomology of schemes. Unfortunately, Yuri Chinkle couldn't make it right now because he's on an airplane.
Well, I want to thank Yuri Yuri in spirit for the invitation to speak. So first I want to apologize for, like, you know, most people here are probably not specialists in this kind of arithmetic geometry. So please ask me any questions that you want to and interrupt me at any time. Yeah, so I want to talk about motivic cohomology of schemes, and this is all joint work with Matthew Morrow. And I want to pose a problem that I want to sort of give a solution to, at least in some restricted setting. So here's the problem. So suppose that X over a field is a QCQS scheme. So just to indicate it is very general. Then the question is, what is a good theory of Chow groups?
So what is QLQS?
Oh, QCQS, quasi-compact, quasi-separated. You can ignore this and just think about a very general scheme. So I wanna emphasize on the generality of this problem, right? So for a very general scheme, what is a good theory of Chow groups of algebraic cycles on X? So what do I mean by that? So for X smooth over F, I can assign to X this graded ring of greater than or equals to zero to the dimension of X of the Chow groups of algebraic cycles of codimension I, and this is a graded ring. Basically elements inside Chow upper I is going to be a codimension I cycle, and you under some kind of cut product you can define a graded ring structure on these Chow groups. So this is if X is not smooth, defining a product on Chow groups on this graded ring is basically impossible in some sense. Okay, so I guess in a number theory seminar, I should talk about number theory. So the Chow groups of algebraic cycles, you know, it's a way that you can, you know, make sense of, you know, right. So the point of the product is to, like, take cycles of, like, complementary dimension and extract numerical invariance out of these cycles. And often they're sort of number theoretically interesting. Personally, I'm not a number theorist, but a lot of people have, like, you know, tried to extract out of geometric information certain numbers, which is of interest to number theorists. But as an algebraic geometer, I'm just interested in trying to define a cut product on the Chow groups of algebraic cycles for any X, which is not necessarily smooth. So let me give an explanation as to why this is basically impossible. So to define a product on Chow groups, one uses the diagonal. So there's a diagonal map from X to X times X over F. And out of this diagonal, I can define something called the exceptional pullback. So this is a exceptional pullback on Chow groups. And this exceptional pullback is not defined unless delta, this diagonal map, is a local complete intersection. So it's cut out by the correct number of equations, basically. So in general, you can define this kind of exceptional pullback for Chow groups, but you're not able to, like, define this basically whenever your closed immersion is not local complete, is not a local complete intersection. So if you have this local complete intersection, what I can do is I can take two cycles, alpha and beta, and this will be, you can define, like, an external product on Chow groups of, Chow star of X cross X. And then the intersection of alpha and beta will be this exceptional pullback of these two cycles. Okay, so basically the point is that this exceptional pullback requires some kind of moving lemma to put cycles in transverse position. And if you do not have regularity conditions on the diagonal, then you're not able to define, you're not able to perform these moving lemmas. And that's not very good. Yeah. And so the relevance is that, so if X is not smooth, then this diagonal map is in general not a local complete intersection. So the regularity of this diagonal map is governed by the smoothness of X. And since I'm in a non-smooth situation, I'm not able to have good regularity conditions on delta, and therefore I cannot, in a robust way, define cup products and Chow groups. Okay.
Excuse me. Questions? What is F? Is it a finite field, a field, or?
It's just a field for now. For now, it's just a field. Okay. Very soon, I'll go to a perfect field of characteristic P, but for now, F is just a field. Yeah, okay. It could be the complex numbers. Okay, so so I want to offer a solution. So I want to offer a solution in characteristic P. So the reason why I'm restricted to characteristic P is because I want to use recent advances in Piatek-Hodge theory by Buttmore and Schulze. But in characteristic zero, this approach seems kind of like not very useful or not very, well, it's much more difficult. But yeah, so I want to contend myself in a situation where I'm in characteristic P. Okay, so I claim that to define a good theory of cycles, it's the same problem as understanding the K theory, so algebraic K theory, of general schemes. So why is that? Well, here's a theorem, which was a big achievement back in the day. So Gosendijk, Riemann, Rock. So a version of the Gosendijk Riemann Rock theorem says the following. So suppose X is over a field, and X and is smooth and quasi-projective. Then on the one hand, I have the algebraic K theory, so just K0 of X. So this is the K theory of, let's say, quasi-coherent sheaves, or coherent sheaves. On X. So before I proceed, does anyone want to ask me what K0 of X mean exactly, or is this okay? Okay, so just isomorphism classes of coherent sheaves, and then you sort of group complete this object. Right, so the GRR theorem says the following. So K0 of X, if I rationalize this, then this isomorphic to the direct sum of I equals to zero of dim X of Chow upper I of X, and also rationalized. Okay, so in other words, to define cup product on Chow I, I can just use a tensor product on the left-hand side. Yeah, so in other words, this object is a ring, so it has a cup product structure, and if I know that if I just want to define a cup product on Chow upper I, then I can just be lazy instead of moving cycles, at least rationally, and define this cup product on Chow groups using the left-hand side, right? So that's one way to do it. And there is sort of a way to think about this theorem in a more robust way. So one to thinking about this theorem So what happens is that there exists there is a filtration. On K0 of X, basically by codimension or dimension of supports of coherent sheaves. And the graded pieces of this filtration or the subquotient are Chow groups. Right, so you can reinvent the theory of Chow groups by saying that there exists some filtration on this canonical, very canonical gadget, and say that the graded pieces of this filtration are just declaratively the Chow groups. And of course, if you have some other a priori definition of Chow groups, then you have to make some comparison theorem. But what I want to do today is to emphasize or like promote the point of view that I want to, if I want to extend the theory of Chow groups, then all I have to do is to define a filtration on algebraic K theory. And declare the extension of Chow groups to be the associated graded pieces on K-theory, and prove a theorem that says whenever I'm smooth, then this coincides with the, sorry.
But I'm in the middle of a seminar, sorry.
It's okay. So the theory of Chow group should just be some associated graded or subquotients of some canonical filtration on K-theory. And what I want to prove in the end is to say that I have not altered the theory whenever I'm smooth, because I have a satisfactory and, you know, good theory of Chow groups for whenever X is smooth over a field. Yeah. Okay. So before I proceed, is there any other questions about this perspective or any of the objects that I've introduced so far?
Is there something similar for mod P coefficients?
I'm going to exclusively work in mod P.
No, but you tensored with Q.
So what I'm gonna do now is to work mod P.
Okay.
And forget about the Q story. Yeah. Okay. All right. So then that begs the question. So what on earth is algebraic K theory? So you might have heard that there exists this thing called higher K groups. So there's K0 of X, which a lot of people are familiar with. And there's also this K J of X, when J is greater than or equals to zero, but there is also KJ of X when J is negative. So there's a thing called negative K theory. Okay, so this Kj of X is going to be the homotopy groups of something called a spectrum, and it's associated to the category of perfect complexes on X. So let me just write some stuff. So K of perf X is something called a spectrum in the sense of algebraic topology. And as a first approximation, if you don't know this theory, you can think about this K perf of X as some kind of chain complex, but it's more complicated than that. And in, you know, for chain complexes, you can take cohomology. And a spectrum, just in the same way as the chain complex, you can take its homotopy groups, which is basically a version of cohomology, if you like. But one thing I want to emphasize, rather than going to the theory of spectra, I want to say that the algebraic K theory of X does not depend just on X, but rather only on the category of perfect complexes on X. Yeah. So perfect complexes on X is the category of chain complexes of, let's say quasi-coherent sheaves, which is locally quasi-isomorphic to a bounded complex of vector bundles. Right, so the point is that algebraic K theory does not depend on X, but rather it only depends on some kind of category of vector bundles or coherent sheaves that I can associate to X. So what happens is that you sort of lose a little bit of the geometry of X, and to recover the geometry of X in the sense of like its algebraic subvarieties and intersection theory and so on, what I want to do is to equip filtration on KJ of X. Okay, so I really don't want to talk about what algebraic K theory is, but I want to sort of tell you some approximations about what algebraic K theory should look like. So we've seen that K0 of X is just related to the coherent sheaves. And you might have heard about another kind of K theory, which is a little bit more simple. So if R is a local ring, then I can associate to R an approximation of K theory called Milner K theory. So let me just write this. So Milner K theory is not exactly algebraic K theory, it's a small piece of algebraic K theory, which I'll make precise in a moment, but it has a very elementary definition. So what you do is you take the units in R, and then you take the following object. So this is the tensor algebra. So you take infinitely many copies of R cross, think about it as an abelian group, and tensor it infinitely many times. So this is a natural ring structure called the tensor algebra on R cross. And you model by a relation given by the following: A tensor 1 minus A is 0, yeah, whenever A is not equal to 0 or 1. Okay, so this is called Milner K theory. So this is a arithmetically interesting object. So suppose R is a regular local ring. Such that a prime, so 1 over L is in R, so L a prime, then there is an isomorphism between the Milner K theory, the jth Milner K theory. So there's a natural grading here given by the natural grading on this tensor algebra. So KMJ of R mod L is isomorphic to object which is kind of familiar to a lot of number theorists. So this is just the jth etal cohomology of R with coefficients in mu L tensor J. So this is the Fields Medal winning work of Vygotsky. Okay, so that's one way to think about Milner K theory. It is some kind of generators and relations presentation of the etal cohomology of a regular local ring when L is invertible in R. Okay. Any other question? Any questions about this idea?
What if L is not invertible in R?
I'm gonna talk about it right now.
Sorry.
Can I also ask? So the quasi isomorphism I know, but what's local quasi isomorphism? This is from above.
So it's Zariski locally. So. Right, so X is a scheme,
yeah,
and this is a complex of quasi-coherent sheaves such that on every open patch, you can find a quasi-isomorphism between E and a complex of vector bundles, but I don't want to choose a compatible system of quasi-isomorphisms.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Okay, so mod P, we have the following picture. Situation. So let's say R is a regular, I'm going to make a more general definition. Let's say R is an FP algebra. Then here's a definition. Okay, so omega j log R. So this is going to be a sub-abelian group of the abelian group of J differential forms on R. Okay, and this is the subgroup generated Zariski locally by the df1 divided by f1 wedge dot 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 wedge the FJ mod FJ, where FJ is an R cross. Okay. So this log suggests something. So of course, if you see log things, you should be expecting to divide by some, you know, by some unit. And indeed, this notation is suggestive of a, you know, of those forms with log poles on R, if you like. Yeah. So this is just a sub-abelian group of omega j of R. And the relevance to K theory is the following. So suppose, furthermore, that R is regular local, so a regular local ring over FP, then a theorem of Geiser-Levine says the following. So on the one hand, you have this Milner K theory, J of R, and I can look at it mod P as someone asked. And there is an isomorphism between this Milner K theory in J degree with omega J R log, right? So an element on the left-hand side just is a bunch of symbol that looks like F1 tensor dot 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 FJ, where Fi is in R cross. And this gets sent to df1 mod f1 wedge dot 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 dfj mod fj. So if you want, this is a real computation of what this Milner K theory of jth Milner K theory mod P in terms of something more geometric and perhaps more familiar to a wider audience than just K theorists. But there is an even you know, an even stronger theorem that says whenever R is regular local over FP, then there is a map from Milner K theory to this actual algebraic K theory of R mod P, and this is an isomorphism. So because in this talk, I really want to emphasize on the mod P part, this is the most interesting part in characteristic P, you can view this computation as like an answer to what algebraic K theory is, at least whenever R is regular local. So it's some kind of logarithmic differential forms of R. Okay. Yeah, any questions about what I've said so far? Okay, so what I want to sort of talk about today. So I want to endow these K groups, or more precisely, the K theory spectrum with a filtration. And the subquotients will be a good theory of cycles that extends the usual theory on smooth schemes. Was there a question? Okay, so I want to do all of this in characteristic P. All right, so let me be a bit more precise about what this means. So here's a theorem. Due to a lot of very smart people, so Lichtenbaum, Friedlander Suslin, Mark Levine, and Voivodsky. So they offered a solution to this kind of problem, or this this kind of perspective, at least in the smooth situation. So let's say X is a smooth scheme over F, and F is a perfect field. Then there is a spectral sequence that goes like this: H I minus J of X mode Z minus J So at this point, you're not really supposed to know what these groups are, but whatever these groups are, they're called motivic homology. That converges to the algebraic K theory, Ki minus I minus J of X. So before even telling you what these are, let me draw the spectral sequence. So it goes like this. So let's say I write Hij to be Hi of X with coefficients in Zj. Then the spectral sequence goes like this. So we have H00, H11, H1, H22, H21, H32, H42. There's maybe something here, H12. So to orient maybe everyone, the differentials go like this. Okay, so in this spectral sequence, the groups, let me change different colors. So the K0 groups will line up along this line. Okay, so let me remind you that I talked about the Grothendieck-Riemann-Roch theorem. So let me just put it up again right here. Yeah, so there's this Grothendieck-Riemann-Roch theorem that says K0 of X, if I rationalize, becomes the Chow groups, okay? And in some sense, this spectral sequence is a massive generalization of this Grothendieck-Riemann-Roch theorem because a theorem of Voivodsky says that H2JJ is exactly the Chow groups of algebraic cycles of codimension J on X. So in these groups, you have the Chow groups of codimension zero, codimension one, which is the Picard group, and codimension two, and so on. And the fact that K zero splits as a bunch of Chow groups tells you that this spectral sequence degenerates rationally. So the rational degeneration of the spectral sequence is telling you that K zero is just a bunch; it's a sum of these groups. Okay, so that's really the perspective I want to sell that. It's better to think about filtrations and graded pieces as opposed to some graded isomorphism. Okay, so let me just go one more. So K1 fits into these groups. And so I talked about Milner K theory just now. And what happens is that, let me just put a different color. So Milner K theory is right here. So this kind of groups. So whatever motivic homology is, HJJ is isomorphic to Milner K theory in degree J. So I said Milner K theory is an approximation of K theory, and to make that precise, is that in the spectral sequence, it forms this kind of a vertical line, basically. So what Voivodsky tells you is something kind of amazing, and this is why he won the Fields Medal, I guess, is that mod L, whenever L is invertible in the base ring, then in the spectral sequence, this guy is just a bunch of Galois cohomology groups or et al. Cohomology groups, which is absolutely not obvious. Okay. Yeah. So any other questions about this?
And mod P, the vertical groups are the log forms.
Absolutely. That's right. Milner K theory is just unconditionally Milner K theory, which is the log forms in mod P in characteristic P. Yeah. Okay. So what happens when I'm singular? Okay. So let me take a copy of this. Okay. So. If X is singular, then new phenomenon occurs. Where by singular, I mean not smooth, possibly reduced, maybe not reduced, I don't really care, but sorry. So let me tell you what happens whenever X is non-singular. So if you look at a spectral sequence, then this H2-1 is like co-dimension one cycles. In other words, this is just the Picard group. And there's something really bizarre about the Picard group of non-singular schemes. So here's a fact. Right, so what I wanna say is that algebraic K-theory is essentially, at the end of the day, just some fancy version of the Picard group. Because the Picard group is really some small piece of algebraic K-theory. So anytime you wanna gain intuition about algebraic K-theory, then you better, you know, first understand what happens in the case of the Picard group, because the phenomenon that will occur in algebraic K-theory will be way worse, or like, you know, more complicated than the Picard group. The Picard group is really just a small piece of algebraic K-theory. But here's a fact about the Picard group. When X is not smooth, and for the you know, geometers out there, when X is not locally factorial, then the Picard group of X, mapping to the Picard group of U, let's say U in X is dense, right? This is not surjective. Yeah. So you cannot naively extend line bundles on the open to X unless X has some regularity conditions, or rather, you know, this locally factorial is enough. But yeah, you shouldn't in general expect the Picard group of line bundles to extend to X. So this is a phenomenon that happens that's governed by some regularity condition of X. So smooth is enough, but you know, if you know the worst locally factorial, then locally factorial is definitely enough. So how does this reflect itself in algebraic K theory? So if X is not smooth, then K0 of X does not surject into K0 of U, not surjective. Okay, so whenever it's not something is not surjective, what you should expect is that there exists something that fits here that is the co-kernel, right? And the reason why negative K theory exists, one motivation for why there's such a thing as negative K theory, is that K minus one of something rectifies the failure of this group to be surjective. So if you want, you can think about this as the Meyerbeer torus long as X sequence, you know, associated to, so let me just say it. So this is like Meyerbeer torus, right? So in topology, if you have a space and you have a close and an open, then you have K0, then you know, you have something like KJ of Z mapping to KJ of X, mapping to KJ of U, and then it wraps around to KJ minus one of Z and so on, right? So it turns out that in algebraic K theory, this sequence is only okay if Z and X are regular. But in general, one has a more complicated description of the kernel and co-kernel of a KJ of X mapping to KJ of U. And in particular, what happens at the lowest degree, what happens to this just case of coherent sheaves, is that this K minus one acts as the co-kernel of this map. Yeah. So, but once you introduce K minus one, sorry.
Yes. Sorry, over here, are we supposed to think of Z as being X minus U?
Yes. Or rather, you should think of U as X minus Z, because Z, of course, comes in some non-reduced structure. Sure.
Yep. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So the failure of this surjection suggests that there exists something called negative K groups. And these negative K groups only appear whenever X is not smooth. Over a field, or I guess regular, not regular. Yeah, so if you are sensitive to these things, what I mean by regular is always Noetherian. So I'm not coming out of some weird regularity conditions. Okay, so let's paste this spectral sequence again. So I told you there are negative k groups, and k1 lies here, so k minus one. Maybe that's a bad color. Let's put white. So k minus one lies should have the groups that filters k minus one has to be along this row. Yeah, and what I want to tell you today basically is a theorem that says we know how to describe these groups, and these groups do exist. But it uses quite a heavy machinery, and this filtration on k0 also gets altered whenever x is not smooth. So I guess there's no filtration when x is not smooth, but using our technology, you can plug in these groups and just declare these groups to be the extension of Chow groups for x possibly singular. Okay, so let's get to it. But before that, is there any questions about this? Okay. So let me tell you a TEM one. Okay, so this is based on the following idea. So we know that this omega j log restricted on smooth schemes over a field is well behaved. And computes K-theory. So I should say from now on, F is a characteristic P greater than zero field and perfect. Okay, so there's a way to sort of canonically understand cohomological invariants or sheaves whenever you know its values are smooth, or like you have some desired behavior of smooth. There's a way to extend this omega j log. And here's how, and this is a contribution of Voivodsky, so the definition, Suslin-Voivodsky. Okay, so an abstract blow-up square is a Cartesian square of schemes, x tilde mapping to x, z into x, and e like this, such that, okay, so I is a finitely presented closed immersion, p is proper, and it's subject to the following condition that P induces an isomorphism between X tilde minus E mapping to X minus Z. So remember, this is Cartesian. This is an isomorphism. Okay, so that's what an abstract blow-up square is. And an example of an abstract blow-up square is, of course, a blow-up square. So you can blow up along Z of X, and you have the following square, which is abstract blow-up square, exceptional divisor. And you know that the blow-up will not touch the complement of Z. Right? So this remains an isomorphism. So there's a way to turn this abstract blow-up squares into covers for a topology. So here's a definition due to Suslin-Voivodsky, is that the CDH topology. So this is a Grothendieck topology on schemes. Is the topology generated by generated by so Z and X tilde mapping to X, where this is a part of an abstract blob, part of an abstract blob square, plus the Nisnevich topology. Which, let me remind you, the covers are X mapping to Y, where this is etal and surjective on field points. Okay, so there's some rather abstract Guthrie topology, but let me make a remark about what this CDH topology does and what the intuition is behind this CDH topology. So remark one, suppose K is a field with resolution of singularities. So like in characteristic zero, you can resolve any singularities using a proper birational map. But what I really mean by resolution of singularities also requires something stronger than that. It requires being able to replace any blow up with a blow up around the regular center. So this kind of like a Waldargic style, zigzag of blow ups. But yeah, you if you don't know what that is, it doesn't really matter, but it's some kind of strong version of resolution of singularities. Then Voivodsky proved that any finite type K scheme is CDH locally smooth. Which kind of makes sense because I'm using these blowups as covers and I can resolve singularities by blowups whenever I have this resolution of singularities. So locally with respect to this topology, I should be able to transform any variety to smooth ones. And this was the motivation for defining this kind of weird Guthrie topology, is to accommodate resolutional singularities in a slick manner. So that's the first remark. The second remark is that whenever you are presented with a Guthrie topology, you should be asking, what are the stalks, right? And the stalks for this Guthrie topology are exactly Hanselian valuation rings. Okay. Any questions about these two remarks?
So for this topology, do you have enough points?
It depends. So if you work over, okay. So let's say X, okay, let me just stick to like some not crazy situation. If X is Noetherian and finite dimensional, then if you look at schemes which are QCQS over X, then this has enough points. Yeah, and this is a recent theorem of myself, Hoiwa, Iwasa, and Kelly. It holds in greater generality because a lot of the schemes that we consider in this project is not finite dimensional Noetherian. But at least in this case, you have enough points. And yeah, I would say this is not very obvious, but it's true.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, right. So here's an attempt at defining like this this Hij for X non-singular for X possibly singular. Okay, so So let me say a small amount of background. So this Hi motivic XZJ is the HI of some complex. So when X is smooth, so this complex is related to cycles in some way, which, yeah, because of lack of time, I won't have time to explain by this block cycle complex. And and the Geisel-Levine can be reinterpreted as the following. So Z mod Pj is the same thing as omega j log shifted by minus j on smooth. Let me say one word about this intuition. So let me get back to the spectral sequence. So what Geisel and Levine really prove is that, remember, the Milner K theory part of algebraic K theory is just equals to K theory. So what happens is that this groups in characteristic P, at least locally, I mean on a regular local ring, is particularly easy to understand, and it tells you that this spectral sequence basically collapses on a regular local ring because this Milner part is the only thing that survives the spectral sequence, and that can be rephrased as saying that this motivic complexes, this objects, which is a priori a complex of algebraic cycles, is actually a single sheaf, right? It's discrete. It's just a simple plain old sheaf of abelian groups. Okay, so from this perspective, I can look at I can define Z mod Pj as the CDH sheafification, or rather the CDH global sections of this omega j log shifted by minus j. So this is a complex computing CDH cohomology. Yeah, so there's a CDH site, as I explained, and you can talk about CDH cohomology. And what I do is I take this pre-sheaf or Zariski sheaf, I CDH sheafify, and I compute a CDH cohomology. So that's one way to define this as a natural extension, because the CDH cohomology basically requires everything to be smooth. I mean, well, it accommodates resolution of singularities, everything is CDH locally smooth. So this is like a naive kind of extension of these objects to all schemes which are possibly not smooth. But this is not good. So here's why. Here's an abstract blow up square, which is a little bit maybe perverse or degenerate. So I can look at X, which is a scheme. I can look at the reduced locus of X. And then here's an abstract blow up square, this empty mapping to empty. Yeah, so this map from empty to X is proper. This is a close immersion. At least when finally presented whenever X is Noetherian, and the complement is an isomorphism because the complement of this map is empty, yeah, and any CDH sheaf takes the above to a pullback square, and so any CDH sheaf is not is nil invariant. In other words, f of x reduced is isomorphic to f of x. So this attempt to define motivic cohomology by simply CDH sheafifying in characteristic P will not work because you lose nil potence. Yeah, so this is no good. Because you lose nilpotence. So remember at the beginning of this talk, I said I want to understand algebraic cycles from the point of view of K theory. So the behavior of algebraic cycles should really reflect the behavior of K theory and vice versa. And K theory is not nil invariant. So, but on the other hand, So let me give you an example, and I will leave this as a fun exercise for the last 10 minutes if you're bored. So K1, right, is some kind of, say, K1 of R of a ring is the same thing, well, R is local, is the same thing as the Milner K theory of R. So this is just basically just units, right? This is just the generators of this tensor algebra. And F2, adjoint epsilon, has different units from F2. Yeah. So K theory is not nil invariant. So this epsilon is, of course, epsilon squared equals to zero. Yeah. So you see, like, because K theory is not nil invariant, if you use this definition where you kill all nilpotents, then you've lost something. And the first time you lose something is in K1. And it turns out that this propagates throughout all the K groups. So you shouldn't be happy with this definition. Okay. And here's a fix. But any questions before I spend the last 9 minutes talking about the fix? Okay, so the fix is prismatic homology. All right, so of course I won't have time to talk about prismatic homology, but whenever X is over F, which is F is perfect in characteristic B, you can associate to this X the prismatic homology of X. So this is the absolute version of prismatic homology. And it comes to the Nygaard filtration. So sorry. Prism X. This is of course due to Butt and Schultz. So. So it is absolute, there's this absolute prismatic cohomology gadget. It has a filtration given by the Nygaard filtration. And there are two maps. One is called the canonical map, the other one is called the Frobenius. And the equalizer of this map is by definition this thing called ZPJ syntomic of X. Okay. So if you know the technicalities of prismatic homology, when X is not smooth, I'm talking about the derived prismatic homology. And of course, this definition is only good whenever X is a ring, and then you have to write can't extend. But as a first approximation, this ZPJ is basically some kind of filtered eigenspace, right? Because you're letting phi and canonical map to be the same, basically. And there's this ZPJ syntomic object. Okay, so this is a cohomology theory which was only defined as of, I don't know, 2 years ago. And and you should think of this as like some kind of a form, like a good theory of etal motivic cohomology. And here's a insight, or maybe due to Akhil Matthew, and I guess, you know, sorry, and Yuri Sulima, who computed this in a large generality, so you can compute the K theory of nilpotent thickenings of FP in terms of prismatic homology, in terms of this ZPJ syntomic sheaves. Okay. Of this thickening. So this is the part which is sort of sensitive to thickening. So prismatic homology and this ZPJ syntomic sheaves understands and like computes, in fact, on the nose in a precise way, the K theory of thickenings. And what we do is we sort of just glue these two phenomena together. And here's a theorem definition. Tomorrow. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to define motivic cohomology with mod p coefficients, for X being just a QCQS or very general scheme in characteristic P. And so we define the following object. So you take our gamma CDH of X with omega J log coefficients. And there's a shift, which is harmless. And there is the Z mod PJ syntomic of X. And this is just a syntomic cohomology, which is, you know, a ZP object. I just take it mod P. Yeah. And there is a map here to a common gadget, which is R gamma. The CDH shiftification of Z mod PJ syntomic of X. So I CDH shiftify the syntomic gadget. There is a map to a CDH shiftification, as there should be. And this map is non-trivial to construct. So this is the hard map. And once you do that, I can define the syntomic complexes. I can define the smotivic complexes as the pullback. Okay. And here's that's just a definition, and here's the theorem. So if X is smooth, so I just defined this in great generality, and notice that I did not make any reference to algebraic cycles. I just use the CDH cohomology, and I just use this new syntomic cohomology, and I just glue them together. So a priori, there's no reason it should be related to algebraic cycles, but let me just say when X is smooth, then let's say a version of this, so we prove that H2J of this Z mod PJ mode of X recovers the char groups of algebraic cycles on X. More generally, if you know blocks are char groups, you get the following: Z mod PJ of X is equivalent to blocks higher char groups, X bullets shifted by minus 2J. Okay, yeah, so this definition, which a priori makes no reference to algebraic cycles, does actually recover algebraic cycles whenever X is smooth. So that's perhaps a little bit surprising. And with respect to this special sequence, what we prove is that whenever X is, again, very general, QCQS over FP, then there exists a spectral sequence going from HI minus J mod X Z minus J converging unconditionally to K theory of X. Well, sorry, mod P. So there's a thing called K theory mod P coefficients. And so this left hand side is an entirely new gadget. And it constructs a motivic filtration or a motivic spectral sequence extending this previous work that converges to algebraic K theory FP coefficients. So agrees with the old motivic spectral sequence of Bloch-Lichtenbaum and Friedlander-Sulzman and so on whenever X is smooth. So let me finish off, by saying that indeed, the char groups of an algebraic cycle of the char groups of algebraic cycles of the char groups of codimension J algebraic cycles on a scheme X, which is of characteristic P, maybe mod P to the J, or mod P. We're just going to define it as H2J motivic, or H2J of this complex Z mod PJ of X. So of course, the justification for this definition is that it does have the correct relationship with algebraic K theory. It agrees with the usual thing when it's smooth. And better is that this right-hand side has a product. So if I take the direct sum of J, this does have a product. Can I take two more minutes? Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay. So maybe let me say where this comes from. So there's a definition like this. This definition. So this definition was not random. I mean, there's an idea behind this definition. And this definition comes from the following result. Okay, so if I want to understand algebraic K theory of X, So perhaps right now I'm sort of talking to people who are more familiar with algebraic K theory. Hopefully some of you are. So there's the algebraic K theory of X, and it sits in the following pullback square. So there's this thing called topological cyclic homology. There is a map here to, okay, so this map from K theory of X to something called the homotopy K theory of X. And this maps to the L CDH shiftification of TC of X. And the fact that this is a pullback square is very deep. I mean, basically it uses all the major theorems of algebraic K theory in the past 10 years. But if you know, once you know that there is a square like this presenting K theory in terms of these three objects, so basically you should think of TC of X as some kind of etal K theory, roughly speaking. And once you know that K theory is presented as these three objects, to filter K theory, you just have to filter these three things. So Batmoro Schulze tells me that I should filter TC using the syntomic homology, and results of Geisler-Levine and Kelly Morrow tells you that you're supposed to filter this homotopy K theory using the CDH sheaves. And it's glued together along the CDH TC and this LCDH of the syntomic sheaves is the thing that filters LCDH TC. So by looking at like sort of the answer, the eventual answer, because K theory is presented as these three theories, you can sort of guess the definition of this motivic complex. Okay, that's a final blurb, and I think I'm done.
Okay, thank you very much for an interesting talk. Does anyone have any questions?
So that product on, can you go back to the last slide, sorry?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that product on the right-hand side, does that come from a product on the chain level?
Of course, yes.
So it's some derived out. It's some derived product in the derived category or something.
I don't know what it means. What does that mean?
Like, well, the right hand term has a product.
Yes.
And I'm asking, is that product induced by some E infinity algebra structure?
Yes, exactly. Yeah, if you take the direct sum across all J, this forms a graded, this is a pullback of graded infinity rings, and therefore there's an infinity structure right here.
And that Z mod PJ mot is the thing you constructed, not the,
Z mod PJ mot is what we constructed and is the pullback of three infinity rings, and therefore this is an infinity ring.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions?
So if X is not smooth and you have a subscheme of X, does it give a rise to a class in this new Chow group you define?
No. So it is not at all clear unless you're in like some weird situation. I think if you're in a situation where you like take cones on smooth varieties or explicit things like that, then you can talk about cycles in X in terms of, I mean, cycles in this new theory as things generated by subvarieties, but in general, it's not clear what the relationship is between, you know, explicit subvarieties of X and this cohomology theory.
But do you have some kind of maps to the,
Chow groups? So you know? The answer is no, because Chow groups, if you're not smooth, is not a cohomology theory. It's a Borel-Mohr homology theory. In other words, it does not have pullbacks, but only as push forwards, right? So the ZPJ mode is a cohomology theory, it has pullbacks. And it is not clear what the relationship is between this and this Chow groups, because Chow groups, again, is not naturally a cohomology theory, but a Borel-Mohr homology theory. So I guess in this approach, I'm forgetting about explicit cycles.
Is there eventually hope of defining this with Q coefficients? Is there eventually hope of defining this theory with Q coefficients?
So the more general theorem, the more general result is that you actually have ZJ in the integral. You do have this. So the Q coefficients is a simpler story. So what you do is that this algebraic K theory, you might know has this thing called the Adams operations. And rationally, the Adams operation breaks this K theory into Adams eigenspaces. And the rational theory is built from this Adams eigenspaces.
Sorry, I was a little confused by your weird blow-up square.
Okay.
Can you go back to that for a second? So,
yes.
Yeah. So you said an abstract blow-up square has a closed immersion, right, on the bottom?
You mean the real blow-up square, or the fake, or the weird blow-up square?
No. Even the definition, right?
Uh-huh.
The definition, yes, is that you have closed immersion, right, on the bottom?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. So your example has the reduced locus including into X?
Yes.
Is this open though?
The reduced locus is always closed.
Oh.
It may not be finally presented if X is not a theorem, but it's always closed.
Okay.
The ideal of nilpotence define the reduced locus, right?
Okay, yeah, sorry. Yeah. Good to read.
Any other questions?
I ask one last question.
Yeah.
Sure.
Can you expect some kind of relative Alexander-Poincaré duality for a closed immersion, for the Borel-Mohr homology of your closed immersion with the cohomology of a pair of the ambient space with respect to this new theory?
So part of the point of this new theory is to avoid anything to do with Borel-Mohr homology. So Borel-Mohr motivic cohomology is perfectly fine. I don't want to fix that anymore. That's like just the theory of higher Chow groups. This is a cohomology theory, which is new. And I think the problem that we solve is that there is a, you know, good theory of cycles with pullbacks. If you want a good theory of cycles to push forward, then you can just stick with the usual theory of like block cycle complex. Yeah. I don't know if that's a satisfactory answer, but yeah, I this is a cohomological counterpart which could not have been recovered from the Borel-Mohr theory.
It was a satisfactory answer. Thank you.
Yep.
All right. Let's thank Eldon for a great talk.
Thank you. Okay. Let me.